it's an honor to be here. I've attended two inner awakenings, one in Varanasi. Including one in Varanasi also, and one in Bidadi. So I'm delighted to be here and meet so many wonderful people. So I wanted to take this opportunity to ask a few questions for our viewers, and I'd like to also put this up on Facebook page later. Starting with, because we are in a sacred place, and tomorrow I'll be meeting people in the Akhara Parishad, so I thought it would be important for people to know about the Kumbh Mela. What is its history? Why we do this? Because there's so many different ideas people have. So I thought coming from you would be the right thing.
Nityanandeshwara Samarambam, Nityanandeshwari Madhyamam, Asmadacharya Paryantam, Vande Guru Paramparam. I welcome Rajivji first and every one of you. The story of Kumbh Mela starts from the Samudra Mandan, when milky ocean was churned and nectar came out. The nectar was protected by Garuda in four different places. That four different places, the space and the place itself became like a nectar. So we take the opportunity to go to that place and experience the Amrita, nectar, immortality within us. It's time immemorial. The earliest available Hindu literatures, all of them speak about Kumbh Mela not as a beginning, as it was happening. Even Vyasa is not speaking of Kumbh Mela like he founded it or initiated it or in his time it started. No, he speaks like as if it is happening forever. Even he speaks Kumbh Mela as a tradition. So when it started, we can't tell. But the earliest Puranas, earliest Hindu literatures also speak Kumbh Mela as a happening, not as if something that they started, it started few thousand years before or it started with somebody. No. So the modern day theories that it was started by Adi Shankara and all is not true. It was much, much before Adi Shankara. Maybe Adi Shankara organized it. So popularized it.
So even during British times, I guess surely, it was continuing.
There was no time Kumbh Mela was disconnected or stopped. Our sadhus took care, even if they have given their lives. Sometimes 10,000 sadhus will start, only 200 will reach the Kumbh Ghat. Remaining all of them will be killed, diverted, arrested, but always that few hundred reached the Kumbh Ghat and did the holy snan, observed the tradition, kept it alive.
Very good. Very good.
It was unbroken tradition. We gave our lives just to keep this tradition alive.
So Swamiji, related to this is the Akhadas.
Yes.
So now I'd like to know who are the Akhadas, how did they start, what do they do?
Akhadas are basically founded by Sadashiva himself.
Okay.
All is Ganas, Shiva Ganas, exactly the word Gana means. In your length, breadth, depth, if you are filled by Shiva, you are Shiva Gana. Whoever lives Shiva, they are Shiva Ganas. All the Shiva Ganas formed the first Akhada. It is directly disciples of Shiva created this Akhada structure. And after Dakshaprajapati was killed, Sadashiva started directly ruling the planet Earth through his Shivaganas. That is the way the original Akkada structure gets formed. Later on, much later, Kapila Muni organizes Mahanirvani Akkada. Then all other Akkadas gets formed. As on now, 13 Akkadas are accepted widely as a mainstream Akkadas. But there are many minor Akkadas who are affiliated to these 13 Akkadas, who work like a sister organization or who work like a branch organization. Ideologically, they feel connected, but they have their independent identity. So Akkadas form the core of Hindu tradition. They are the oldest and largest apex body of Hinduism. As on now, at least 10 lakh sadhus work under the Akkada Parishat, which is the apex body where all the 13 Akkadas are member, which is completely a democratic setup.
Okay.
It is like a, all the Tanidars gather together and elect Kotari. Okay. All the Kotaris together gather and elect Mahant. All the Mahants together gather and elect the Sri Mahant. All the Sri Mahants together, they gather and elect the Mandaleshwar or Mahamandaleshwar, then Acharya Mahamandaleshwar. So it is like a pure democratic setup.
Very interesting.
And nobody can do things on their own.
So no king came and interfered and said, I'll appoint somebody.
No. Actually, we appointed kings many times because our army went and supported many kings in their wars. We chose their successors.
So Akkadas are also kind of, they can do physical defense.
There was a time Akkadas were not only doing physical defense, they were waging wars for the sake of Dharma and sending armies in support of various kings. Akkadas were one of their main responsibility is teaching Shastra, using Astra to protect the Shastra. So Shastra and Shastra,
yes,
both were the main responsibilities of Akkada.
Very interesting. So sort of like modern commandos in one sense, but also intellectual Kshatriyas. Intellectual Kshatriyas.
I think in the modern day we don't pick up weapon.
Yes.
Because the war is not actually in the modern day with weapons. It is all about intellectual ideas.
Right.
So
is this Nirvani linked with Buddha's Nirvan idea?
Buddha got initiated in Nirvani Akkada.
In Nirvani Akkada.
You see, I can give you 5 points.
Okay.
The word Sakya Muni is actually the name of Kapila, Sankya Muni.
Okay.
So Kapil Maharishi is the founder of Mahanirvani Akkada.
And Sankya became Sakya.
Sankya Muni. Kapil Muni is called Sankya Muni. So because he took sannyas from this tradition, Buddha is called Sakya Muni.
Okay.
Second, the word Nirvana. Nirvani Pita, Nirvani Akkada is thousands of years older than Buddhism. Buddha picked up that word from Nirvani Pita. And third, this is the Kashi, is the spiritual headquarters of Nirvani Pita, where Kapil Maharishi's Jiva Samadhi is there. This is where usually sannyas is given. So Buddha took sannyas from here. And next important thing you need to know, still Mahanirvani Akkada's 52 madis, 52 branches, Buddhism is one of the madi. And still Buddhists receive the respect and recognition as one of the madi of Nirvani Akkada.
So does Dalai Lama accept this?
Yes. All Buddhists accept because it is traditionally, and they have to accept. It is not something started yesterday or day before yesterday.
Right.
It is there forever, as they as one of the Madis, and they do accept and attend many places, many ways. The name Nirvani and Sakya Muni, many of the teachings of Buddha is based on Sankhya philosophy. And
the one of the madi, 52 madis of Nirvani, Buddhism is one. With all these facts, you can see very clearly, Buddha took the whole structure of Buddhism from Mahanirvani Sampradaya.
Very good.
From Mahanirvani Akkada. It is Mahanirvani Pita, which is the source of Buddhism.
So all this talk about Hindu-Buddhist difference and clash and conflict.
Surely.
Buddhism, all this political later.
Surely, these are all much later drama to weaken Hinduism.
Yes.
See, all the traditions came out of Sanatana Dharma. In the modern day, they are projected as if they are separate, just to weaken Sanatana Dharma.
Right.
Otherwise, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, all of them are from Sanatana Dharma. This is the source.
Yeah.
So what even the modern day Hinduism is from Sanatana Dharma.
Sure. So what about the property where the four Kumbh Melas are held? Is there some special relationship the Akhadas have?
Yes. Till recent periods, all four used to be under the control of Mahanirvani. Even now, the many properties where the Kumbh Mela is held is in the hands of Mahanirvani Pita and Juna Pita. These two Pitas even now retain many of the properties. As you know, a lot of the modern day illegal occupancy, all that goes. Other than that, even now, in Allahabad, in Haridwar, in Nasik, and in Ujjaini, the major places where the Kumbh Mela happens, Akkadas retain huge properties, and even those temples, Mahakaleshwar temple, used to be under Mahanirvani Pita completely till recent times.
So
where the Ujjaini, where Kumbh Mela happens.
Sure.
Very recently, government has intervened, and even now some kind of a mid-level arrangement where Mahanirvani Akkadas representative continues to be a major decision maker. Kind of arrangement is done.
So what but about Harki Pauri in Haridwar?
Harki Pauri, other than small bits given to different organization, it used to be owned by Mahanirvani Akkada. Even now, Mahanirvani Akkada has a big say in all that land and area. Maybe recently, some of the legal complications have raised. Other than that, originally, it used to be under Mahanirvani Akkada.
Very interesting. So, it is really the Akkadas have...
It's Akkadas conducted the Kumbh Mela.
Protected
the Kumbh Mela.
And the land.
And the land where the Kumbh Mela is held. And one more thing, in the recent days, lot of illegal occupation and different interferences from the political powers, bureaucrats and all that, that took away many of the land holdings. Otherwise, in Haridwar, a major part of the Haridwar belongs to Mahanirvani Akkada. So Akkadas are actually the official hosts of Kumbh Mela. I can very comfortably say, without any bias.
It's a very big thing.
Without any bias, very comfortably I can say, till the modern government interference, Akkadas used to be the host of Kumbh Mela, and all the religious, spiritual traditions and the method of conducting everything was under Akkada Parishad, means the under the Akkadas.
So I would really like that to be restored because it will safeguard it. It will safeguard it.
And it used to be under Akkadas. Even now, the major chunk is under Akkadas. And as you know, the unsaid interferences.
Yeah, yeah, the secularism and all those things have
happened. Everything.
So, Swamiji, now Akkadas have been protectors. But now there is a global Kurukshetra. The game is changed. So now the threats are coming from all over the place. Also very sneaky. So for instance, there is a Harvard project to study the Kumbh Mela. But under the pretext of studying, they're looking for opportunities to intervene in the name of human rights. Either they're showing gender bias or caste bias or north-south divide or environmental pollution going on or people doing superstitious primitive things. All kind of stuff like that. So they're calling it data. And a very dangerous thing is that they're collecting a database of attendees in the Kumbh Mela, making a database of their mobile numbers, which village, district they come from, what caste, where, who they belong, which sampradaya. So then they can track these people. So they first use Sam and Dan to bring them on board and feel like they're helping. And later will come Bhed and Dand. This has been the strategy. So I'm studying this and I find that unfortunately there is not much awareness and a lot of people don't want to bother.
I should accept what you said. As Mahamandaleshwar of Mahanirvani Akkada, I can speak for me and the people whom I know. We are really not even aware of this Gurukshetra. To tell you honestly, we are in our happy slumber. Unhappy, cozy feeling. We get few people touch our feet and have few bandaras and have little dakshana. We are happily there. It is unfortunate that still we have not woken up to the reality. I have no right to criticize anybody, comment on anybody, but I can do self-criticism.
Yes.
To tell you honestly, still even I have not woken up to this reality of intellectual international Kurukshetra going on. When you explain, I understand the gravity, but we have not woken up to the reality. That is the straightforward, honest truth.
Because I think,
I will be very sincere working and trying to share and inspire my colleagues to wake up to this reality, to wake up to the war being waged on us. But as on now, we have not woken up. That's the truth.
The beauty is the openness, but others can take advantage of it. Too much openness means we can also be inviting infiltrators who don't mean well.
The problem is, actually, openness does not need powerlessness.
Yes.
But in the name of openness, somewhere we become powerless. And openness does not need that we need to lose our identity.
And authenticity.
Authenticity.
Rituals, practices,
Somewhere in the name of openness, we even lost ishtanishta. The ishtanishta.
Yes.
The authenticity is getting diluted. We need to wake up to this reality.
So, but it is very tempting and fashionable to say that in the name of openness, you know, everything is invited. But then conversions can be happening, people can be doing the shnan and calling it baptism.
Everyone should be invited to celebrate the core tradition.
Our tradition.
Which is our tradition.
Yes.
The Hindu tradition.
Yes.
You see, Kumbh Mela is the celebration of Hindu tradition.
Right.
Celebration of all the Hindu sampradayas.
Yes.
Celebration of all the Sanatana Dharma sampradayas.
Yes.
So everyone should be invited to celebrate that, not to pollute that.
Right.
We come to celebrate Ganga, not to pollute Ganga.
Yes.
We come to celebrate Sanatana Dharma, not to pollute Sanatana Dharma. It's very unfortunate. There are sources, there are plans polluting the Sanatana Dharma, trying to hijack Kumbh Mela, but unfortunately, still we have not woken up to the truth. We have not woken up to the truth, and still it has not gone into our spine. I don't know.
Yeah, because partly the public relations is so smooth. People feel that they are actually giving us a gift. They give us some free food, or they give. So the average common man is very happy that all these people have come and they're doing this for us. And the risk is also the secularization of Kumbh Mela. So one day there might be a Coca-Cola tent, and there might be a Reliance tent, and you know, it could become like a commercial mela to generate sales, because if you have 100 million people, you can sell them a lot of things. So this is a, then it becomes not sacred, it just becomes like any other gathering which anybody can rent a tent and do what they want. So it could become that, like
that,
a big tamasha.
That danger is there, and it is unfortunate we have not woken up to that danger. We have not woken up to the danger, and I cannot comment on others, other organizations. At least I can tell you, as Mahamandaleshwar of Mahanirvani Peetha, we have not woken up to the danger.
Can certain things be made legally mandated, like for instance, non-veg is not going to happen, and alcohol, can there be, or is it a matter of somebody
and
saying, well, this is what I want to do?
Actually, it should be done. If you ask my opinion, it should be done. And I will also talk to the Akadas and insist on bringing these kind of changes by working with government and doing what needed to be done legally and formally in the country. We should bring some of these mandates. No, it should be no alcohol, no meat zone. So that sanctity is celebrated at least during that period of Kumbh Mela.
Yes.
From Peshwai to last Shahi Snan, at least during that period when Dharma Dvaja was raised,
right,
until the Dvaja comes down, the traditionally Dharma Dvaja is raised the moment Peshwai happens, and only after the last Snan it is brought down. And till that Kumbh Mela period, at least we should keep that place dry, means without alcohol and without meat. That will maintain the sanctity. There should even be some more mandates, like there should not be any other commercial or secular activities.
Or other non-Hindu or Hindu-phobic activities. Because they also want to preach against Hinduism right in the Kumbh Mela.
There are a lot of abusive documentaries made
against
Naga Sadhus, against Kumbh Mela.
Right.
And showing us as very primitive people,
right,
showing us as in a very low understanding.
Like it's some exotic circus, you can come and enjoy watching these weird people.
And it was made to, there's a lot of attack. Unfortunately, even we have not woken up to it.
You know, in China, to get a foreign group wants to come and do some social research and gather data, they have to apply for a certain research permit. And then one of the conditions is that a copy of whatever data they have gathered, before they can take it out, they have to deposit it. Now here, research on Kumbh Mela is going on, and no authority in this country, Akhada or government, knows what it is. They don't even know what this data is, much less being able to be ready and argue against it and respond to it. So I think there needs to be some body, some intellectual body for protecting the Kumbh Mela that is vigilant, that is doing purv paksh on what the other guys are saying and responding to them.
It is a need of the hour, what you are talking.
Yes.
It's need of the hour. I think the Akada Parishad should do this. I'll surely recommend to Akada Parishad and put all my effort for this to happen.
Yes.
Because some way Akada Parishad need to become aware of the war happening. In those days, the wars were different.
Local. Visible.
And just with ordinary weapons like a sword and trishul and all that. But now the war is in a different scale. Still Akada Parishad, we have not woken up.
And the war is so sophisticated that one side might not even know this war going on until they're finished.
Actually that is what is happening.
Yes.
We do not even know war is going on till we are finished.
Yes. So this this intellectual dimension of looking at the other side, examining, responding to them, needs a different skill set than the Akadas have.
Yes.
So then they also have to open up, collaborate with some people who they can trust and have some kind of a collaboration.
Not only that, the charcha, the vakyartha satas should go in this direction.
Yes.
See, Akada has a great tradition of sitting as a panch and discussing. and making decisions. It's a great democratic setup.
Yes.
There, not only the earlier conversations, ideas, debates, now this new debate, new idea should be brought.
Yes.
Akadas should start discussing about it. And surely I'll do everything which I can to make these debates happen and put these ideas, make all the Akadas understand the threat we have.
That's very good. Hmm. So Swamiji, I wanted to also going beyond Kumbh Mela, our system is so rich, so can you give some ideas on health benefits of your teachings? Physical, mental, all kind of health benefits.
You see, when it comes to the benefits, whether it is a prevention of disease or maintaining the health or curing or having the best mental setup, peace, joy or bliss or ecstasy, and being far away from depression, handling life, everything, including manifesting the extraordinary powers, everything is available in our original source texts, what we call Veda Agama, Vedas and Agamas of the Hindu tradition. Whatever I am doing is bringing life back, reviving the original science as expressed in Sanatana Hindu Dharma. Whatever experience, anubhuti I had by my Guru's grace, Atma Pramana, I compare with Apta Pramana, Shastra Pramana, the ancient master's experiences. And I do acid wash all my Atma Pramana with Apta Pramana. Whatever my personal experience, Atma Pramana, I do acid wash them with Shastra Pramana, Apta Pramana. Whatever finally stands after the acid wash, I share it with the world as Sakshi Pramana.
Very good.
Which becomes Sakshi Pramana. I also wanted to tell the whole world through this opportunity, everything you need is available in our Shastras. Always learn from the Gurus who have personal enlightenment and abide by the Shastra Pramana. Anybody who does not have personal enlightenment will not even understand the scriptures completely. They will be just pundits. They will not be able to give you experience. Some of the people who had few satori, one or two experience, but does not adhere to Shastra Pramana, there is a danger that their experience may be good for them, but not for whole world.
Yes.
Even if somebody is enlightened, what they should share with the world and what they should not share with the world will be decided only by Shastra Pramana.
Very good.
Every person, whether he had enlightenment experience or not, what he shares with the world should be decided by Shastra Pramana. Shastras gives a complete view of what can be shared, what is good for the whole world. Some of the gurus, the way they are brought up, they will be vegetarian. They may not be drinking alcohol. So they will do some sarasasan, the stomach cleansing techniques, all this. It will work for them. They will have experience. But because they do not refer the original scriptures, they don't understand
the vegetarianism and no alcohol is a basic requirement for these kriyas to work. Yam, niyam are requirements for these other components of yoga to work. They start thinking these actions alone are enough, and they start teaching when somebody who drinks regularly alcohol, if he does sirasasana, I guarantee he will have mental problems. I have done enough of research in this.
So it cannot be dismissed as cultural frill.
Some it of them cannot be taken out
yes.
in the name of cultural frills.
Yes.
Everything Patanjali mentions. That is why the word is Ashtanga Yoga, not even eight steps, eight parts.
Part altogether.
Anga.
Anga.
The word Ashtanga Yoga is not eight steps that you go to the second step, you leave the first step. You go to the third step, you leave the second step. You go to the sixth step, you leave all other steps. No. It is not steps, it is Anga.
Right.
Unfortunately, some gurus, when they do not read the scripture or respect the scriptures or revere the scripture, the source manuals, they cause more danger to society than the help. So even if somebody is enlightened, what they teach to the world need to be acid washed through the scriptural strength.
So the key is having had the experience and
referring to validating it
with the text.
With the text.
Before transmitting it.
Transmitting. See, because many things which we have practiced without even knowing we practiced, even that needed to be taught to others.
Right.
See, sometime, for example, Ishwara Pranidhana, Patanjali says, surrendering to the ultimate. We would have practiced it as a simple flow, because any child born and brought up in Indian village tradition learns surrendering to Sadashiva as like a how he learns to breathe. But we forget when we teach to the world, they may not have had this background and experience. They need to be taught this very systematically, scientifically.
Yes.
So even if we are enlightened, even if somebody is enlightened, he has to refer and adhere to the original scriptures when he wants to teach something. When the knowledge needs to be transmitted, that is the only safest way, method, the spiritual knowledge, spiritual experience, spiritual enlightenment can be transmitted. I do request the people, please always understand, learn only from the people who have experience and referring the scriptures.
So all this secularization, dilution is a kind of distortion.
Because, surely,
yeah.
Surely, nothing is a cultural frill in yoga.
The whole system has to be taken.
Whole thing has to be lived.
Yes.
Whole thing has to be lived.
Yes.
Yoga has not accumulated any cultural frill. Sadashiva is brilliant enough to make a system which keeps itself pure forever.
Very good.
Which has self-purification method. Even Ganga is able to purify herself.
Yes. Yes.
Surely, Sadashiva created a system which keeps itself pure, alive, and nothing can get accumulated around Sadashiva's system.
So a lot of people who call themselves Hindus need to be converted to Hinduism.
They need to start living Hinduism.
Yeah, yeah. Because
so they're, this is, you see, they are only born Hindus.
Yeah.
But they need to live Hinduism.
Just symbolically.
Mm-hmm.
Just a kind of a name.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is where I wanted to discuss. You know, I'm studying the whole influence of Indian dharmic traditions on the West. And I'm going to write a book on this whole thing. It seems that the Buddhists officially, formally said, okay, I'm converting you to be a Buddhist. Dalai Lama did that. But the early Hindu gurus in the 60s and 70s said everything is the same. Doesn't matter. You can teach, learn this breathing or learn this asana and you can just continue who you are. So the people got mixed up. They, you know, it's like you have a cup with the tea in it and you, it, there's little tea left and now you pour coffee and you don't have either one, you know. You have to clean it first. So that cleansing and reinstalling for the new idea didn't happen. So I think a lot of these people with good intentions did not get rooted. So it seems that there needs to be, for people who are outsiders, who are Westerners by birth, who want to be genuinely become Hindus, there needs to be a procedure where they can actually be made to feel that now you are a Hindu and you will claim that, you will officially call yourself, you will fight the battles of Hinduism and you will just live like that, no matter what anybody says. That way they, it's good for them. Do you feel that's the case?
See, it is very unfortunate. People who are living Hindus were not inspired enough to become official Hindus.
Yes.
They are living Hindus.
Yes.
Unfortunately, people who don't have clear root did not guide them to be official Hindus. It is time we open our doors for living Hindus to become official Hindus.
Very important. And this is
for living Hindus to become official Hindus.
This is why what I call the U-turn, where people make this U-turn back to their tradition, does not happen so much with Buddhists. Westerners who are Buddhists, they stay. Because they've been told, now you are a Buddhist. And we, you are part of our Sangha. So we need to do that as Hindus also. Welcome and anybody and make sure that they are they're living the life and make, give them responsibility as leaders. I think they want it also.
And the it is time that we open our doors for the people who are living Hindus to become Hindus.
Yes.
And I tell you, the moment you bend your body for Surya Namaskar, you are a living Hindu.
Yes.
And the moment even you decide to do yoga, yoga means what? It has already two presumption. There is cosmos and you are a jiva with multiple life. And you have to unite with the cosmos and reach the oneness. That is yoga. So the moment you start practicing yoga, you understand the oneness, you understand multiple lives, you decide to become one with that cosmic oneness. So the basic ideas and truths of Hinduism is part of yogic psychology.
Very true.
This cannot be separated. Basically, the moment you bend to do Surya Namaskar, you are a living Hindu.
Yes, very good. So, the courage and the clarity required is that certain things are not going to mix. Like idea of sin, original sin, that this is how I'm born.
In yogic tradition, there is no idea of original sin.
Yes, that's a very important.
There is no idea of original sin.
We're originally divine.
You are Amritasya Putraha.
Yeah.
Upanishad very clearly says, Shrunvandu Vishve Amritasya Putraha, O sons of immortality, please listen to me.
Yes.
So basically our first declaration is, Shrunvandu Vishve Amritasya Putraha, O sons of immortality. There is no question of original sin in yogic tradition or Hindu tradition.
So this whole project that your problem is original sin, and your solution is one exclusive solution, that whole thing has to be dismantled.
No, that is not there in yoga tradition, in yogic tradition.
Yes.
The moment you bend for yoga, naturally that is no more part of your being.
This is why I was disappointed when somebody goes to the United Nations and says that yoga had nothing to do with Hinduism and in India, because it seemed like a bit very making a joke out of it. And that's unfortunate.
No comments.
Yeah, no comments. I'm happy. Yeah. So the next thing I wanted to discuss is this whole idea of siddhis. People are skeptical and afraid of siddhis So for instance, third eye awakening, even though it's empirically shown, because I think they feel that either it is some kind of black magic and something wrong must be going on, or they somehow uncomfortable with it. But I wanted to have your view, because I feel that siddhis are basically science which the ordinary person has not yet discovered, and few people have discovered. So if some airplane is flying over a very primitive society, they will think that this is magic, that this is some kind of a miracle. But it is not a miracle to the person who understands it. So one quality is that there are knowledgeable people for whom it is just a scientific thing, and it can be taught. Now that is another thing. Sai Baba had siddhis, but he was not teaching others to have them. But you have siddhis and you're teaching others to have third eye awakening. And this idea of the fact that many other kids have third eye awakening, and they are free to go and be measured, evaluated in scientific clinics. You haven't stopped them. They can be evaluated.
And we are doing everything to make it more and more scientific, and means studying all the, we are encouraging all the studies.
Yes, because you know, also it's very interesting that different children are having different experiences. So depending on their own level and their own conditioning and whatever, somebody sees it from here, somebody sees it from there, somebody can see clairvoyance, distance, somebody else cannot. So we are discovering, just like scientists, discovering lot of interesting things which did not fit the old thought. And then they have to find out why it is like this, and if you heat the temperature, then it becomes something else. So they are discovering all these things, and now now we have to figure out. So this is the stage I think we are in, the rediscovery and revalidation of ancient knowledge. Do you feel that that's how we should look at it? Siddhis as science?
I'll present the basic few truths. People have one stupid fellows who think it is not possible. They are too stupid.
Yes.
That is one group.
Yes.
Second, kind of a paranoid that it is stopping our growth towards enlightenment.
Yes.
Which is not true.
Yes.
I wanted this important truth to be understood. Patanjali speaks siddhis as destruction for enlightenment, because the methodology he provides is, when you are traveling towards enlightenment, you will manifest these powers. That is the science based on what Patanjali is offering.
Right.
There's one more science by Sadashiva much before Patanjali, called Shashtanga Yoga. In Yogapada, there siddhis manifest only from the space of oneness. They do not manifest on the way to enlightenment. So Sadashiva calls them as Shaktis, not Siddhis.
Okay.
So the science I am following is from the Yogapada of Sadashiva. The more you experience enlightenment and oneness, more you will manifest powers. What I am presenting to the world is not siddhis as described by Patanjali.
Okay.
It is Shaktis as described by Sadashiva.
This is very important.
Sadashiva gives a structure called Shashtanga Yoga. Patanjali gives a structure called Ashtanga Yoga. Both lead to enlightenment. Sadashiva has delivered it in Agama 60,000 years before. Patanjali is actually a disciple of Sadashiva. He delivers it the way he understood and way his generation needed it. When he lived, what was the need of the people, for him, for them, he delivered it. So what I am offering to the world, whether my kids doing third eye reading, or they are able to see what is happening somewhere, even thousands of kilometers apart, I think you can have your own personal experience.
Yeah, he told me many things, yeah, correct things.
And seeing beyond the distance, all these are not siddhis as described in
Patanjali Yoga Sutra by Patanjali, they are Shaktis as described by Sadashiva in Shashtanga Yoga, in Agamas Yogapada. In Agamas Yogapada, Sadashiva very clearly describes. So, these Shaktis do not stop somebody reaching enlightenment. And they manifest only if that person is rooted in the enlightened state. See, for example, if you ask a person who does third eye reading from Patanjali tradition, he will say he concentrates himself and completely centers, does pratyahara, dharana, and then he manifests that power. But if you ask my disciple how he is manifesting the power, all he will say is he goes to that oneness. That oneness is manifesting the power. There is no concentration. There is no meditation. Dharana, dhyana, samadhi has a different meaning in Shashtanga than the meaning in Ashtanga.
Very good.
The tradition I am following, I have been taught by my gurus, is the tradition of Sadashiva's Agamas.
Very good.
It is based on Upanishads, practiced as Agama. So the whole idea is different. It is not Siddhi, it is Shakti. And it is not before enlightenment, it is after enlightenment.
That's
it is not towards the oneness, it is from oneness. It is not of enlightenment, it is from enlightenment.
That's very, very impressive.
That is the major difference. That is one. Second, when we do not analyze the Shastras thoroughly, many gurus criticize my initiating people into healing. They do even openly declare healing should not be done. These powers should not be manifested. And some gurus even openly declare, when they were asked about third eye, for God's sake, don't try to open it. I do not know what is the reason and what is the context, and I have nothing to comment. But one thing I can be sure, whatever I am saying now, I am responsible. What I am teaching is from original Agamas Yogapada. The science very clearly declares, Sadashiva is very clear, manifestation of these powers happen when you experience oneness with Sadashiva, not on the way to experience oneness with Sadashiva. Patanjali declares all these siddhis are experienced on the way to Nirvikalpa Samadhi. So they can be distraction to Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Sadashiva very clearly declares these are manifesting in his tradition. You see, each tradition has a structure, a separate architecture. Separate architecture. You may be surprised, in Shashtanga, Sadashiva talks about a different ways, and he explains the pranayama pratyahara in a totally different context. So the whole structure is different. There he says very clearly, these powers start manifesting from experience of oneness. Means after the Nirvikalpa Samadhi, they start manifesting.
But the Patanjali system became more popular, at least nowadays.
See, Patanjali system became popular, Sadashiva's system did not become popular for various reasons. Because the Sadashiva's system needs somebody who is grounded in that. It comes more with the guru disciple parampara. Patanjali, you can just pick up a book on the shelf. You do not need a guru. You don't need to read a Sanskrit. You can be very proud about you don't know the Sanskrit language. And it can be easily hijacked.
Yes.
But the Sadashiva system needs a basic requirement of initiation by enlightened guru.
Shaktipat.
So Shaktipat. Shaktipat, initiation and training by an enlightened master. So naturally, the requirements and prerequisites of this tradition did not allow this tradition to be mass circulated,
which is very good actually. It protects it.
Good or bad, that is one. Yeah. This is the reality.
This is the reality.
This is the reality. But just because Patanjali's system has become popular, no one has a right to say, other than that, no other thought current exists.
Right.
And anybody who manifests these extraordinary powers is only expressing siddhis, and that will distract people from enlightenment. The whole thing is irrelevant when you are in the path of Sadashiva's as per Yogapada of Agama. Because here, whatever is manifested, there is no concentration or any mind game used. It is from the oneness expressed. They are not siddhis, they are shaktis.
That's very good. Beautiful.
And I also want to assure all my disciples and followers, express, manifest as many powers as Mahadeva describes. You will not be deviated from the enlightenment. You will be more and more rooted in the oneness experience. You do not need to have the Oris generated by Padanchalas. You are Adishaivas. Lot of confusions about Siddhis is because of Padanchalas, the followers of Patanjali. And unfortunately, even in the system of Patanjali, they have not reached the Nirvikalpa Samadhi. So they are not able to understand some other traditions exist.
Right.
It's some other possibilities exist.
Yes.
See, Sadashiva very clearly says, every pattern you complete and achieve completion manifests as one power. Shakti. Playing with that Shakti, manifesting that Shakti, does not take you away from enlightenment. It grounds you more and more in oneness. Manifesting and playing with the power itself becomes a spiritual practice to be grounded in oneness in Sadashiva's tradition.
Very good.
Anybody who is ready to challenge me as per this tradition, I am ready to face them for Vakyartha Sadas or Kandana Mandana or Vada Pradivada.
Good.
I am open. And I will also demonstrate these siddhis and prove to them they are not siddhis as per Patanjali's. They are pure shaktis as per Sadashiva. See, there is a big difference. When somebody expresses siddhis in as per Patanjali, his brain will not show Turiya state, the ultimate awareness and ultimate restfulness.
Yes.
I can demonstrate the siddhis not only through me, any of my disciple, not only they will manifest siddhis, their brain will be in the same frequency of ultimate restful awareness and ultimate awareness.
So some
which is Turiya, so the oneness state.
So neuroscientists should do some brain scan work on these students.
Which we are already working, which we are already started doing.
That would be should be published in scientific journals.
You see,
because that's very solid proof.
When somebody is in the state of the ultimate awareness and ultimate rest, that can be clearly recorded by the modern day equipments,
yes,
which we have tried many times, and it shows very clearly that no thought, that yes, Turiya state.
Yes.
In whenever my disciples manifest powers, it always shows the brain is in the Turiya state.
Right.
It means it is not Siddhi, it is Shakti.
Right.
They are manifesting oneness. They are not having these powers when they are towards oneness. When they are having these powers, because they are rooted in oneness.
Now this is to me the two most amazing things that I'm learning from you. One is this, the human potential, the higher human potential than what ordinary people have discovered, higher than what science has discovered. So a lot of people are threatened.
And I also wanted to tell you, if anybody is honestly open to know about these powers, I am open to share with them the science and Sadashiva's science and I have no copyright. I am very clear. I am very clear. I have realized whatever Sadashiva said, and I have experienced. My contribution is only reinvention, not discovery. I have reinvented whatever Sadashiva shared. So it belongs to whole world, whole universe. Anybody who is interested, I am open.
Very good.
For them to take it, practice it, enjoy it, and share it with the world, not to distort it.
That's very good. So I think that this is itself an amazing achievement. And the other one is the Kumbh Mela and the Akhadas, correcting them, making it protected, bringing awareness so that, because I feel that the earlier part of our discussion on Kumbh Mela, I feel that with a properly protected Kumbh Mela, you can use that as a revival of all Hinduism.
Yes.
And this is why it has been targeted for attack, because once they can attack that, they can attack all of Hinduism. Mm. They know that yes. is the center. Mm-hmm. So these two things, from the oldest tradition of Kumbh Mela, bringing it to the modern times, and the oldest tradition of the Shiva Sutras and the Agamas, and bringing that to modern Shakti.
Shiva Sutras, Vijnana Vairava Tantra, Spandakarika are all part of the Shaiva Agamas. Shiva has delivered 108 Agamas. 28 is popular in South, 64 is popular in North.
I need to come and study more with you. I started, some of my studies were with the works of Lakshman Ju.
All the Kashmiri Shaivite works are Shivagamas.
Yes, yes. They all Kashmir Shaivism, the whole very powerful.
There are various branches of Shaivism.
Yes.
Vera Shaivam, Adi Shaivam, the Kashmiri Shaivism, and Lagulishwara Shaivism, Pasubada Shaivism. All these various branches of Shaivism are from the same root, Adi Shaivism, or the Agamas. Because each of these branches calls their original scripture as Agamas. And as they have Sadashiva as the source. See, all traditions which declare Sadashiva as source, I call as Shaivite tradition.
Swamiji, I am glad that neither Max Miller translated, because that could have been distorted, nor this new Murthy Classic Library translation by Sheldon Pollack has targeted those texts, which means they ignore them, so people who are authentic can control them and translate them properly, because otherwise it would all be misinformation. This is also, so in a sense, being ignored and left alone is a blessing in disguise, because then it is not distorted, and a true teacher can come and enlighten.
And I also wanted to invite, see, there were many gurus who were criticizing indirectly that what I am teaching is siddhis. Some of them don't even accept that it is siddhis. They say it is bogus. Some of them genuinely say, no, it is siddhis, because it is so undeniable. But it is blocking the enlightenment or diverting people from enlightenment. I wanted to sincerely request them, if you are interested in attacking me, go ahead, do that. I have no problem. I have seen enough. And I don't care. But if you are sincerely believing it and you want the truth, now I am sharing it. What I am doing is not siddhi, it is shakti. It is being established in oneness. What you know from Patanjali and what is from Sadashiva is totally different. In Patanjali structure, I am not saying Patanjali structure is inferior. No, that is the structure. In his structure, powers manifest when you are towards enlightenment. In Sadashiva structures, powers manifest when you are from oneness.
Big, very clear, but very big difference.
So, what we practice here are not siddhis, they are shaktis.
They're shaktis.
Totally different. So, if those gurus are really interested, I am open, available for them. They can see what is happening here.
Maybe I'll go and propose that we should have some kind of sammelan or gathering or discussion.
I am verily open, available for it.
I will propose that. This is an absolutely amazing opportunity for me to clarify for myself and bring to my people who follow me and discuss with me this new kind of knowledge.
And I also wanted all of them to know, I am responsible for my disciples' enlightenment. I will never do anything which puts that in jeopardy. So when I am helping them to manifest these powers, they can be rest assured they are manifesting shaktis, not siddhis.
Excellent.
So they do not need to worry about the traditions of Patanjali, and they need to be very clear and free that they are following Sadashiva.
Excellent.